Hey guys, and what's going on? Well, welcome to another video. So, you guys have probably been wondering, like, when the hell is Cannibal gonna release another video? Well, I've been working on this shit all damn week. So, yeah. And this video is over an hour long, so I hope you guys enjoy it. I'd also like to give a thank you to my good friend, Creepy Pasta Goblin. He's a creepy pasta narrator, and I really enjoy his content. And he's got a sexy Irish accent that I think you'll all enjoy. But yeah, so I hope you enjoy this long-ass video. And the last story in this video is something very different that I haven't done before. So I can't wait for you guys to hear that. If you guys would like more longer videos like this, like actual hour-long length videos filled with stories, comment on this video. I'm actually thinking of doing it like once a week or maybe just a couple times a month or something. So if you would like to see more long videos like this, let me know. As always, I love you guys, and remember, stay hungry. I'll start out by saying that I'm not a writer by any means. I suck at it, but I will try my best. For a bit of backstory, my mom was dating an abusive prick at this time. We'll call him Ian. Because of Ian and the crazy fights they had gotten into, we couldn't lock up my house at all. He had kicked in both the front and the back door to the house, and they never got it fixed. My mother and Ian were at the bar all day, every day. I told you this so you would know why the house wasn't locked up and where my parents were when this happened. This incident occurred when I was around 12 years old, and my little brother was around 10. I was a really small girl at this age, and my brother was sick all the time, so he was very, very tiny and frail. My mother and Ian were at the bar as usual. When you opened up my front door, it would put you in the living room, and you could see the back door. There was a hallway to the right that led back into the bedrooms, and that is where my brother and I were. We were in his bedroom with the door closed, playing something on PlayStation. It was around midnight or 1 a.m., and we were playing and having a good time when I heard a weird noise. My brother didn't hear it, and I didn't want to creep him out. I told him that I wanted to get a drink and told him to stay in the room and I would bring him something. To get to my kitchen, you would have to walk down the hallway, in front of both the front and back door because it was behind the living room. I kept hearing strange noises, so before I left out of my brother's room, I told him to get into the closet and work on our fort so that it would be ready when I was done getting our drinks and a snack. I raised my little brother for the most part and took care of him. I then had a terrible feeling, a sense of dread. I could tell something wasn't right, and this was a way to get my brother to hide without scaring him. He frightened easily and had really bad asthma attacks, and at this time we had no inhaler or his breathing treatment machine for him. I knew if he started having an asthma attack on top of being scared, it wouldn't be pretty. Anyway, I left the back room and decided to see what was going on, because I was such a badass at 12 years old, but I had to protect my little brother. I started sneaking up the hallway as slowly and quietly as I could. I was terrified. I could feel that something was wrong. Before I made it to the end of the hallway, I hear a man. It sounded like he was growling. It was a deep, terrifying noise. I can't explain it, but the feeling that washed over me damn near made me puke. So I, of course, freeze. I have no one in this town. I don't know anyone, and my dad is living in a different state, and my mom is at the bar drunk as hell. I was sitting there trying to gather the courage to see what was around the corner and going over my options when I hear my brother's door open. He sees me and the look on my face and freezes. I remember his eyes going so wide with fear because he must have heard the growl or whatever it was too. I motion him with my hands to go back into the room and he does. I gathered the courage to peek around the corner, and what I saw still freaks me out to this day. It was horrifying. I saw a man, probably around 6'6 and 300 plus pounds, sitting on my couch with a wicked grin on his face. That grin and the look in his eyes will forever be burned in my head. By some stupid luck, the man didn't see me. I slowly, so slowly, snuck back into my brother's room. I slowly shut the door and started going over my options. My little brother was already horrified because of the growling noise this man was making. I am so thankful he wasn't the one who saw what was out there. I mustered my brave big sister face and calmly told him that there was a man that I didn't know on the couch and he needed to be very quiet, and that I needed him to be brave and keep his breathing in check. My little brother adored me and he looked up to me, so when I told him that I needed him to be brave, he tried his best. I told him not to move and he didn't. The first thing I tried was the window, but it wouldn't budge. It was completely stuck. I'm making myself stay calm for my brother's sake, but I know what's sitting out there. So since the window was stuck, I decided to start looking for a weapon. My older brother lived here, and I know he had swords somewhere. I don't remember where he was. As I'm looking for a weapon, I hear the man sing.
I know you're here.
Fuck. My stomach knotted up, the hair on the back of my neck raised, and I instantly got a cold sweat. And then I hear it. My little brother had started wheezing. Asthma attack. Fuck, fuck, fuck! I hugged him and reminded him about being brave and told him to sit still and focus on his breathing. I started frantically trying to get my window open, but it was stuck. I looked around and started moving blankets when I find my older brother's cell phone that he always forgot. I remember thinking that I was lucky and felt a bit of relief. I immediately called the police and told them what was going on, hysterical at this point but still remaining quiet. The dispatcher told me to remain on the phone so she could hear what was happening when the man started banging on our bedroom door. It had been about 5 minutes into the phone call when this happened, and I could no longer remain calm. I fucking lost it. I started screaming. I mean blood-curdling screaming. The kind of screaming that would send chills down your spine if you heard it. I forgot to mention that our bedroom had the only working lock, so the door was locked. He was trying to get in and banging on the door. His banging got louder and louder. He was screaming to let him in, when it completely went silent. Then, he did the creepiest, most terrifying thing ever. He started fucking laughing.
You know, I could just bust this door down in about 2 seconds, right, little girl?
Now he's lightly knocking on the door and asking for me to open it. His demeanor completely changed. I then heard a scraping at the door. What I had imagined it was in my 12-year-old head was that he was scraping the door with his really long fingernails or something. But that wasn't the case. Then, I hear the police start screaming at him to get on the ground and to put his hands up. I heard him putting up a fight, followed by more yelling and eventually, silence. After a few minutes, there was a knock on my door, but at this point, I was too terrified to open it. I thought that this nightmare guy was still there. So being in my hysterical state, I started screaming, "No, no, please!" over and over again, sobbing and shaking. I couldn't stay brave for my little brother anymore. I was on the floor holding him this whole time, convinced we were going to die. Eventually, I calmed myself down a little bit, and this time a female officer was at the door, so I opened it. There were about 5 cops standing in the hallway, listening to me being hysterical. I refused to let go of my brother at this point, but we both ran to the female officer and just collapsed, sobbing hysterically. We had never been so scared in our lives. It turns out, this guy was completely wasted and high on drugs. I remember the cops walking me up to him and having me stand in front of him to ask me if I knew who he was. I didn't, but I'll never forget standing in front of this huge man, looking into his brown eyes that were completely bloodshot and filled with hatred. I'll never forget that growling noise that he was making, or the look of pure horror in my little brother's eyes. My parents were called and investigated for leaving us alone like that, and for the doors being the way they were. My mom is a different person now. She doesn't drink and is now married to a cop. She completely changed. I remember asking her about it later on, and she told me something that I didn't know. The man had a huge knife, so that's what he was scraping the door with. And he also had some rope, tape, and a tarp. I still don't know how he didn't get to us, or why he didn't just bust the door down to get us. It would have taken one half-ass kick from him to kick the door down. It was super thin. It still creeps me out to this day, and I have had nightmares from it. My husband doesn't understand why I get so furious with him when he leaves the door unlocked at night. I work third shift, so I'll come home and the door will be unlocked. It's infuriating, because then I have to go through every room in the house and check the closets and the other places that a person could hide in. I have 2 kids, and they will never, ever go through what I did. So creepy, crazed drug man and product of my nightmares. Let's never, ever meet again. In the late 70s, my uncle was studying medicine at the University of Chicago. After a morning class, he decided that he would hitchhike back home to Lincoln Park on the north side instead of paying for a taxi. A man drove up in a Plymouth Satellite and offered my uncle a ride. The man looked normal and seemed friendly. Lighthearted even. So my uncle got in the car and they started driving towards Lakeshore Drive. However, once they got there, the man drove south on Lakeshore instead of north towards Lincoln Park. My uncle told the man he was going the wrong way and to turn around and head north. The man looked at my uncle, put his hand on his knee, and then said,
"No, son, you're coming with me."
And then smiled darkly at him. My uncle froze in panic, and when they hit traffic near the South Shore, he quickly unlocked the passenger door and ran away without looking back. A year or two later, on a cold December day, my uncle was having a coffee in a cafe with my future aunt when he caught something on the TV that made his blood run cold. He saw the man that picked him up from school that day, the year before. He had been arrested for the suspected rape and killing of over 20 young men and boys. The man on the television was John Wayne Gacy, and he had removed the door handle off the passenger side door to prevent the man he picked up from escaping.
I am sometimes too nice to my friends. I tend to do favors for my friends even if they seem pretty ridiculous, as long as it's not terribly out of my way. Most of the time it's, "Help, I'm drunk and need a ride home." Well, one night at like 1:30 a.m., I get the call. A very, very drunk friend of mine, Claire, is begging me to come pick her up and give her a ride home. The bar is closing soon and she's too drunk to drive home. The bar she's at isn't too far from my house, about a 10 to 15 minute drive. But the issue is that she lives like 35 to 45 minutes on the other side of town. Claire has been extremely nice to me in the past, and I did owe her a solid, so at about 10 to 2, I grab my keys and my concealed carry and leave the house. I get to the bar at around 5 past 2, and she's sitting outside on a bench by the doorman. I pull into the parking lot, which was pretty empty since the bar is closed, and I assume that the cars remaining were the workers who had yet to leave. I get out of the car and start walking to Claire, who was kind of slumped over. I was hoping she wasn't passed out drunk. And when I got to her, the doorman asked me if I was her ride, David. I told him yes, and showed my ID for proof. And what he said next was of some concern. He kind of pulls me in and says, "Hey, I was supposed to leave when we closed, but I have a strong feeling your friend was roofied. She's been on the porch drinking all night, and some guy kept hovering around her. I assumed it was a boyfriend or whatever, but she never turned to talk to the guy. She was either drinking or chatting with other girls around her. Well, anyways, she chugged her last drink, came up to me and told me you would be coming to pick her up. And she asked me if she could sit by me. She told me she felt very dizzy and sick. I told her, sure, hoping she just drank too much. And she passed out right after she sat down. After that, I couldn't see that guy anymore. But I didn't want to take any chances. So, visibly concerned, I thanked the guy profusely, and he even helps me carry Claire to my car. Midway through carrying her, she's kind of coming to, like someone just waking up after surgery. That really groggy, not knowing where they are, talking of nonsense kind of talking. I don't remember exactly what she's talking about, but I'm sure if I wasn't on high alert about her possibly being drugged, it was some funny shit. So we get her buckled in, I thank the guy again, and he just says he hopes she gets home safe. So now, hoping my friend is only stupid drunk and not drugged, I start driving to her house. The whole time I'm trying to keep an eye on her, and an eye on the road. She's now snoring asleep, which puts me at ease a bit. But about halfway to her house, my fuel light comes on. Cursing the fuel economy of a sports car, I pull into the next gas station. It's one of those small gas stations that doesn't have a 24-hour store, so I'm on extra high alert while I start to pump gas. The gas station is about a block from the freeway, and right at the corner of the intersection. The street itself is pretty dark, with lonely lampposts shining very pitiful lights at large intervals. I get that really dead feeling, like this place is just abandoned. To give an idea of positioning, because this is important, the gas station is at the corner of the intersection. The storefront would be facing south, and we were right in front of it where the pumps were. The east would be where there are air pumps for tires and parking spaces, and the north would be a diesel fuel pump right behind the store, accessible from the street behind the gas station. I drive a Corvette, so the filler is on the rear end of the car. And I'm leaning against the rear looking around. To my left, I hear this weird metallic scraping sound. So I turn and see this guy, about 15 to 20 feet from me, coming around the corner, dragging a long metal pipe on the ground. I immediately sense that I'm in a possibly dangerous situation. The guy looks almost possessed, but he's not looking at me. Rather like he's trying to look into my car. I'm on the defensive, but hope I can get him to leave, so I call out, "Hey, everything all right?" Without looking at me, he answers back, "You took my girlfriend from me. I'm here to take her back." Now he turns to look at me, and he's got blood in his eyes. Before he begins to take a step, though, I start yelling, hoping it'll get him to back off. I'm a little over 6 feet tall and not exactly skinny, but not exactly bulky either. But I have a really deep voice. "Back the fuck off. Turn around and leave, and no one has to get hurt." He takes a step towards me, clearly unimpressed. So almost automatically, I pull my handgun from my inside the waistband holster and draw a bead on him. "Back the fuck off. You don't have to die." I start yelling louder, pretty sure my voice cracked because A, I'm scared shitless. No amount of self-defense classes and time at the range prepares you emotionally for this kind of situation. B, even though I carry, I'm really against violence, and killing someone is not something I want to do. And C, did I mention I'm fucking scared? Anyway, in a panic, the fucker throws the pipe at me. It whizzes by, thankfully not towards my car, but to my right. And I dive behind my car for cover. I have no idea if he has a gun himself or what, but I was going to put some kind of cover between me and him. And by the time I kneel up and aim over the rear of my car, he's booked it. I hear a car door slam and tires screech, and he launches off the curb on the east side of the lot and is tearing down the road, swaying all over the place. In my own panicked hurry, I pull the pump out of the car, screw the cap on, and tear out of there myself. Claire, however, is still passed out in my car. And now I'm afraid, because I'm convinced she's been drugged, and we were followed by that guy. Me being more concerned about her earlier and keeping on the road, I must not have noticed being followed. The whole way back to her house, I'm wary of any car that's behind me. I'm also driving very aggressively. Read, speeding like a jackass. And when I get to Claire's neighborhood, I circle a separate block that's not hers 4 times to make sure no one followed me. When I was satisfied thinking I wasn't being followed anymore, I pulled up to her house and tried to shake her awake. She's doing that groggy waking up stuff from before, but now she's able to get up. I'm able to wake her, thankfully. I was worried I was going to have to call an ambulance if she didn't wake up, and I get her keys from her bag. I manage to walk her inside and, at this point, she's kind of coming around, asking me what's going on, where she is, etc. I tell her she's home and get her to lie down. She's completely lost looking, and her eyes start welling up. She clings to me and starts sobbing. She's still very out of it, but I'm guessing she realizes something bad was going on, or attempted on her. I was able to get her to lie down and get her to sleep. I write a note for her which pretty much said, "Hey, I'll be in the next room. We're going to the hospital in the morning to get you checked out." Fast forward to the morning. She's sick as a dog, and after she expelled some demons from her stomach, I drove her to the hospital, where she got tested and treated. I still shudder to think what might have happened had I not had my CCW with me. I do know martial arts, but that's not something I want to take against a crazy person with a pipe. Claire still doesn't remember much from the night, except calling me and wanting to sit next to the doorman. My advice for you guys is, either be with friends you trust when you go out, or at least be vigilant if you're by yourself. That night could have ended badly in 1,000 different ways, but thankfully, even luckily, everyone made it out safe. This occurred roughly 14 years ago, when I was 12 years old and living in the east side of the Australian rainforest. When I say rainforest, our house was on a 40-acre property surrounded by bush. The house itself was owned by a Swiss man named Hans. Occasionally he would come down with his tractor and slash the long grass surrounding our house, so he could access slightly more of the property in the summer. It was also extremely handy because, if you know anything about Australia, is that we have tons of beasties that can very easily kill you. We lived about a 40-minute drive from the small town center. This meant that if we needed groceries, medical attention, or to contact our parents, say, while we were at school, it would be a 40-minute drive before anything could be done. The house sat on the side of a large mountain, roughly 3/4 of the way up. So naturally, most of the land we called home was strewn with valleys, nooks, and hideaways. We had trails we could walk, and they led to a stream and a small waterfall, a 5 or 6 meter drop. It was a truly beautiful place, but considerably scary to me and my small siblings. I had one brother and one sister, slightly younger than me. We knew our neighbors on both sides of the property, but because the location of our house was pretty remote, our nearest neighbors were roughly a 10-minute drive away. One was a lovely old lady who used to wave to us when we got off the school bus before we made the trek to our house every day. I think our parents asked for her to keep an eye on us. The other was a middle-aged man and his family. He was a real jerk who excavated around the bottom border, where our properties met, and continuously interrupted the stream and waterfall's clear flowing water supply. Lots of strange and creepy shit happens when you're living in the middle of nowhere. But one in particular involved a guy I certainly don't want to meet again. Being pretty removed from people, it was extremely rare that we ever got visitors we didn't know were coming. When people we didn't recognize turned up, it was usually because they were lost and needed directions. One day though, a man in a ute came roaring down our driveway. I remember running inside to tell my dad someone weird was here. He immediately walked outside to see who this unwanted guest was. A little background about my dad. He is literally the most hardcore person you will ever meet. He has one leg after having one amputated earlier in his life after a motorcycle accident while he was running from the police. He was in the Navy and he was brought up in a very strict household. He had grown up in a very rough part of Sydney's West, so he had some pretty shady contacts too. In short, he is someone you really wouldn't want to fuck with. I wouldn't be surprised if he had killed someone in his life, prior to having kids. Anyway, my dad goes outside to see what all the commotion is, while my mom keeps us inside, being protective. The man has a large red furred dog in the back of his car that looks like a German Shepherd cross. It snarled at my dad, but immediately cowered when the stranger told it to shut up. Our own dog, Millie, renowned beast killer just for the record, was snarling and going ballistic while being chained up on the house. "Hi, my name's John." The way the man spoke was like a salesman. A really slick and smooth guy who, on the outside, seemed friendly, but with the overtone of wanting something. My dad immediately responded with, "So what the fuck are you doing here then, John?" The man was taken aback, obviously not used to dealing with someone as hostile as my dad. They then talked for a while and I could hear my dad talking with a sense of confusion about whatever this man had to say. I did, however, overhear my dad say, "What the fuck are you thinking? Just call the cops." I found out later that the lovely old lady next to us had died. Apparently John was on the other side of her property and went to visit and found her dead. He also asked my dad if they should move the body to make it easier for police to investigate. This is obviously why my dad was telling the man to call the police immediately. Anyway, later that night the police showed up to take a statement from my dad and John, who was hanging around at our house until the police arrived. I remember my dad pulling an officer aside and explaining that John wanted to move the body when he first arrived. The police left without any more questions, as it looked like she had died from natural causes. John was still at our house. I found him to be a very unsettling person. The way he smiled, the dark of his eyes. He was unfamiliar, but acting like he was one of us. I remember it was a school night and I was trying to watch TV, and he was playing songs on his guitar with my mum and dad at the table. I was angry because he was ruining my shows and I told Mum I wanted him to go, and that I thought he was weird. She smiled and told me she felt the same, and told me I should go to bed. The next day, things seemed normal. I went to school and came home. Not seeing the familiar friendly face of the old woman stung a bit on my way past her house. It felt strange, and I hoped that she knew her family loved her before she passed. I was a bit sad on the walk home, until halfway down the driveway, I noticed John's ute again parked outside the front of our house. I walked closer and was greeted by his dog, Rusty. He walked outside with my dad, and I heard him call Rusty to his car as he was leaving. Apparently he was borrowing tools from my dad. He left and waved goodbye, like he was someone that I was going to miss. Again, that sense of over-familiarity made me feel uncomfortable. I didn't know this man. I didn't like this man. And I was hoping he would never come down our driveway again. My dad then pulled me aside and asked me what I thought of John. I labeled him a weirdo and told my dad I was hoping he wouldn't come back. For the second night in a row, when John returned Dad's tools, he was sitting in our house playing guitar and annoying everyone. My mum and dad were visibly unimpressed by the situation. I heard my mum and dad argue about him hanging around, until eventually my dad told him he needed to leave, as it was time for us to go to bed. He insisted it was early and tried to make an excuse to stay. I found that very odd. I was polite enough to know when someone didn't want me around, so why didn't this man? Or if he did know, why wouldn't he leave? After ushering him out, my mum and dad had a big talk in their room, and my dad told us all that he didn't like John, and that he was going to ask him not to come over anymore, and if we saw John again, immediately tell him. The next day was a Saturday, so we were going to blow up our cheap inflatable pool and go for a swim, as it was getting pretty warm. Around 11 a.m, the sound of a car thundering down the driveway alerts me, and I go outside. I run back inside to tell my dad that John is back. Just like the first time I ever laid eyes on John, my dad goes outside, and we stay inside with Mum, watching and listening through the screen door. John, again with his weird, over-familiar smile and dark eyes, greets my dad, and is met with, "Look, mate, I don't know who you think you are, but I don't want you coming around here anymore. You scare my kids and my wife, and I don't want you to come back. You understand?" I didn't hear John's reply, but from his tone it sounded like he was confused and tried to reason with my dad. Dad wasn't having it, and told him to go or he would call the cops. As he was leaving, Dad said, "Don't come back, or you'll be sorry." This is where things get truly weird. As my dad lays this subtle threat on him, his face completely changes to one of rage. He glares at us in the house, sticks up his finger and speeds up the driveway, shouting profanities and churning up gravel, spraying it towards our house. My dad came back and told us we wouldn't be seeing John anymore, and if we did, we were going to call the police. I was relieved. This odd man made me feel uncomfortable in my own home, and the way he reacted when he left confirmed the feeling I got from him when I first saw him. I can't remember if it was the Sunday or the Monday after that day, but John did come back. He tried to reason with my dad and say sorry for whatever caused us to not like him. Before he even got out of the ute, my dad said, "If you don't turn around and leave, I'm going to smash your face in." He did just that. My dad then called the police to inform them of what happened. Apparently they were going to go and talk to John. I didn't hear any more of what happened to that conversation. A few weeks went by with no sightings of John, and we all felt like things were back to normal. This was until our mailbox was tipped out of the ground and smashed, or possibly run over. I remember asking my dad what happened, but he wasn't about to give me any ideas. He later told me that he knew it was John after the way their last conversation ended. The next weekend, after the mailbox incident, we went into town to get groceries and a fast food dinner as a bit of a treat. And when we came home down the driveway, my dad immediately stopped my mum from proceeding and said that something was wrong. Next to the carport, where we parked our car, at the back of the house, there was a window that opened to the bathroom. My dad must have spotted the window was missing. As we drove down, he got increasingly more tense until we all noticed the window was missing. I remember being confused in the back seat, not really knowing what was going on, until I saw it. A man, dark eyes, over-familiar, coming from the window that led to the shower. My dad was exploding with rage. He told my mum to rush down the driveway so we could fuck this guy up. The man proceeded to escape the window, and run down the back of our property into thick lantana, which is a really thorny shrub-like plant. My dad, only being on one leg, let Millie loose as she was going ballistic tied up to the house. She raced down the lantana-engulfed hill into the darkness. She came back with nothing. My dad went out with his flashlight and couldn't find anything either. I'm not sure if anyone slept that night. None of our possessions had been stolen or even moved. We must have caught this man just as he was entering our house. The police came the next day and searched for fingerprints to no avail. My father was furious and again alerted them to John and his strange behavior. They told us they would look into it once again. That was the last time we heard from John that year. I had almost completely forgotten about him and had the summer off to enjoy myself and get ready for high school. The school I went to was pretty large considering where we were, but everyone seemed to know each other pretty well, including the teaching staff. Within my first week at the school, we were introduced to all the teachers and teacher aides. I was caught completely unaware when that over-familiar dark-eyed man from the previous year was reintroduced as a teacher aide. Except instead of John, he was introduced as Gregory something. I went into a little bit of a spin as I was trying to make sense of it all. I was 100% sure that this man named Greg something was the same man who had introduced himself to my family as John. At that moment, so many things rushed into my head. What if he killed the old lady? What if he didn't live close by? What if he wanted to move the body so he could frame my dad? If he lied about something as critical as his name, what else was he lying about? What if police never even made contact with him? I was sitting there for a good 10 minutes trying to piece it together until the teacher called my name to bring me back to reality. That is when he noticed me. The look on his face when he saw mine was one I'll never forget. He immediately recognized me. He looked shocked. His eyes were wide and he said nothing, just staring. I had just found out his dirty little secret. I could sense that he was now the one feeling uncomfortable and on edge. Later that day, I rushed home to tell my dad who I had found. He was shocked and repeatedly asked, was I sure? He went to the school the next day and discovered the man had put in for indefinite leave yesterday and may not return. When we learned of the news, my dad told me to watch out and let him know should John or Greg ever return.
So this happened to me when I was 15 years old. I was a super lonely kid. My home life was shambles. My mom was cheating on my dad and told me about it. And I had just started at a new high school the year prior where I didn't know anyone. Creating art quickly became my biggest coping mechanism. To this day, I still love to draw. I discovered the website DeviantArt around this time and started submitting my drawings every day. Through this, I made some friends online of all ages. Some very talented people were giving me positive feedback on my work, and this really inspired me. In my deep depression, I felt like DeviantArt was a safe haven of like-minded people who all appreciated one another. For the first time in a long time, I belonged somewhere. I spent many hours talking to some regulars on the site. Even now, 10 years later, a few of them are still in my life and I cherish their friendship. But this story is about someone who I never want to meet, ever again. DeviantArt also allows writers to submit their stories or poetry to the site. One day, I was on the front page and a poem caught my eye. It was more of an angry rant, full of weird, twisted imagery and anti-Christian subtext. It sounds stupid, I know, but it was actually quite well written and funny, at least to my 15-year-old self. Being a very angry and depressed high schooler, I was drawn in and decided to check this artist out. Not only was he a prolific writer, with maybe 100 poems and story on his site, but this man was a very talented visual artist as well. He created amazing illustrations of weird, funny creatures. Some of them were a little sexual, like naked women, but most of them were humorous or gross. His name was Tom. The combination of Tom's writing and visual art skills intrigued me. Even though he was 30 years old, I decided to send him a private message. We bonded. Soon we began to talk on AIM, which is AOL Instant Messenger for those who don't know. I would look forward to talking to Tom every day, and came straight home after school to connect with him. Chatting for 5 hours was a daily thing for us. In hindsight, my family probably wondered what I was doing, but they never said anything. Anyway, isolating myself in my room wasn't abnormal at this point. I was so grateful for my artistic friend, I could be as dark and confident as I wanted to be when we talked. I unloaded a lot of my pain onto him, and he told me about his troubles as well. Tom even started to write poetry about me, happy poetry. It made me feel very special, because I had softened this angry dude's heart with my friendship, so I thought. He was reliable, always online whenever I came home. After maybe a 3 weeks of talking, Tom asked for my phone number because he wanted to hear my voice. I was extremely uncomfortable with this and reluctant. He insisted, and gave me his number to call. Fearing I would lose a friend who was so important to me, I finally gave in. I should mention that I'm 23 now, and I'm still a shy person. But at 15, I was painfully awkward and detested phone calls. My heart was racing, and I was shaky and sweaty as the phone rang. Tom picked up. "Hello?" My voice sounded shaky. Tom spoke. I knew his age, but to my relief, he sounded like a teenage boy. This made me feel less uncomfortable, but still weirded out. I had no idea what to talk about, and for some reason I felt like crying. Tom and I spoke for a bit. He laughed at the awkward things I said, so I guess the conversation went all right. Honestly, I can't remember what we talked about. All I remember is that he barely spoke at all. We got off the phone and then talked online some more. He said how happy he was to hear my voice. I was still pretty upset, but I was glad that I didn't disappoint him. I hoped he wouldn't ask me to call him again, because it was such a stressful experience. But I had poured so much time into talking to this man, that I was willing to be uncomfortable to preserve our friendship. My self-esteem was non-existent. The next day, Tom wanted me to call again. On the phone, I could hear him breathing heavily. He was masturbating. I talked about my day at school, some random thoughts. He stayed silent apart from breathing. Then, when I was mid-sentence, he hung up on me. When I asked what had happened over AIM, he told me I wasn't talking about anything sexy, something along those lines. I apologized and felt a total sense of failure. The conversation then turned sexual. I told him that I was a virgin, and in reality I hadn't even had a real first kiss. Tom was overjoyed by this. Now I really had his attention. At this point it was May. Our relationship progressed to the point that I let him jerk off to my voice, and even sent him some pictures of me in my underwear when he asked. I had no idea what I was doing, but I felt like I had to obey him or he wouldn't be my friend. He started to write poetry about taking a girl's virginity. To his fans on DeviantArt, they were just fictional poems about a fictional girl, but I knew they were really for me. This both thrilled me and made me queasy. My 16th birthday was coming up in June. Tom and I constantly talked about how badly we wanted to see each other. In the back of my mind, I really missed the days before everything got so sexual. I told him there was no way I could ever fly to Florida where he lived. Tom insisted on seeing me before my 16th birthday. Eventually, we picked a date. He found a hotel near my family's house that was relatively affordable, and even bought tickets to fly out. The plan was that I would skip school that day, and spend the day with him so he could take my virginity. I can't remember if he was even going to stay more than one day, to be honest. Before we said our goodnights, Tom wrote, "Will you let me get your ass too?" Not a question, a statement. I came home from school one day and my mom was extremely solemn. She told me she knows about Tom. Apparently I had remained signed in on AOL, but I think she actually got my password to see what I was up to. I began to cry and defended Tom at first, but then I admitted I was terrified of him. I was so ashamed that my mom saw our sexual conversations, but she hugged me and told me, "He won't be coming, I promise." She emailed Tom, which really fucking spooked him. Tom began to yell at me and blow up my phone. He told me he spent $500 on the plane tickets that he couldn't get back. I never picked up any of his calls. He wrote me tons of emails in all caps. I have a few of them saved. He wrote angry and violent poetry on DeviantArt about how I betrayed him. I was devastated and hated myself. On the day Tom was supposed to come visit, I stayed at my best friend's house, which was miles away in a totally different community. My mother gave our apartment building a photo of Tom to make sure nobody let him in. I was totally paranoid that he would pop up for a while after that, but he never did. In fact, I didn't hear from him at all. He stopped submitting any art or poetry. Over a month went by, and Tom was still MIA. My family and I went to Canada for a music festival. Life was slowly going back to normal, and my guilt was fading. Suddenly in our hotel room, My phone rang. It was Tom. I tried to pick up, and I can't remember why, but for some reason, since we were in Canada, I couldn't talk to him. I think it's because I had an American service provider, or something. In any event, he left me messages. My memory of this is very foggy. He may have actually been texting me. I can't remember at all. A few days later, we took a train back to the US, and as soon as we crossed the border, I sent him a text. I apologized for what happened and I explained that I was in Canada, but that I missed him and I hoped he could forgive me. Tom told me the reason he was gone for so long. He said that on the day he was supposed to come see me, he got very drunk and tried to kill himself. He stabbed himself all over, including his stomach, left hand, and legs. Feeling last-minute regret, he called his mother and she called the police. He told me that his whole apartment was considered a biohazard from all the blood. And after he recovered, he spent time in the psych ward. Tom had mutilated himself so badly that the hospital had to amputate his leg, and he lost two fingers. He told me this was all my fault. I was utterly speechless, and my blood ran ice cold. I refused to believe him, but lo and behold, he uploaded some pictures of himself on DeviantArt. His leg was amputated above the knee, and he was missing fingers. I had seen previous photos of him. This was my friend, all right. It's hard to explain how I feel about this situation. I feel very sad for Tom, but I also understand that this wasn't my fault. I was a very lonely child and desperate for a friend. Tom was a schizophrenic man and a pedophile, as was later revealed by his explicit poetry about little girls. Eventually, he was banned from DeviantArt, and I never talked to him again after the age of 16. A few years ago, I looked him up and found his profile on a different site. Admittedly, I was Googling him to see if he was still alive. In his profile picture, he was next to a young woman with his hand over her mouth. It looked like he found someone who was willing to visit him after all. So Tom, I hope you're okay, but please, let's not ever meet. Hey guys, before I end this video with this final story, I'd like to mention a few things. This story is not your typical scary Let's Not Meet story. The main reason I decided to cover it was because it was so different than anything I've done before. I don't want to go into full depth, because I don't want to give away any spoilers. But, I will tell you you're in for a treat. But I also wanted to do this story, because it's fairly new to Reddit, and I don't think any other channel has covered it. I actually sat down and recorded this story for 2 hours straight without any breaks, and it took me days to edit it. I would also like to add that this story is verified by a mod on Reddit, which isn't an easy thing to do. I'll read a quote from Reddit about the verification process. There are two ways to get your story verified. You can message the moderators with a news article, police report, photo, or some other form of third-party verification. So there you have it. You have to have actual proof in order to get a story verified. But all this being said, let's get to this long-ass story. I love you guys. And here we go. Let me give you some background for this story. I'm an almost 28-year-old gay male, who was born and raised in the Appalachian Mountains, which for my friends not in America, that's in the south more towards the mid-Atlantic region. I usually don't throw my being gay out there, but it's very important to my tale and to understanding why I made such insanely poor choices in my teenage years. I know almost everyone does, but this really takes the cake. Follow me back to when I was 16, just about 12 years ago. I was a junior in high school. Had plenty of friends and no trouble with bullies. At least, not while I was at school. My parents are now wonderful people, who greatly regret the way they treated me when they found out I was gay. At the time, I hated them for being so horrendous to me. But as I got older, I finally understood that their reaction was just a product of the strict religious movement that they and myself were brought up in. Mild disclaimer, I do not have any hatred in my heart for any religion no matter what its views are. Whatever you choose to believe is alright by me. I'm more of a treat people the way you'd like to be treated kind of guy. This just happened to be my parents' reaction, so don't judge them too harshly. Also, I don't want the comments to turn into a huge religious debate. My parents, who at the time firmly believed that this would send my eternal soul into damnation, pretty much only allowed me to stay at our house a couple days a week after that. For at least a year, I was living on friends' couches and off the kindness of their parents. I was in what I can only describe as the worst state of miserable, major depression I have ever been in my entire life. I had tried to commit suicide the year before, with a very serious overdose that cost me 9 days in the ICU. I should have died, but your liver is an amazing thing, and it started to regenerate on its own. A year to the day after that, literally, the day, the first guy I ever fell in love with was killed in a tragic car accident. My parents had zero sympathy for my feelings. They were the immoral feelings of their blasphemous son, so in their minds, they didn't count. I remember coming back home from his funeral that night, and my father asking me, "Why are you so upset? Were you a faggot with that boy or something?" I didn't even respond. I just walked right past him and straight into my room, where I proceeded to cry myself to sleep. Again, try not to judge them too harshly. They were entirely different people back then. Needless to say, this sent me completely spiraling downward in the worst ways possible. Drugs, alcohol, you name it, I did it. Anything to stay numb and to keep myself from feeling the immense amounts of pain I was in, emotionally, every single day. To have your situation go from a year before seeing your father cry for the first time as you lay dying in a hospital bed, to him spewing so much malice and hatred towards you. Let's just say it was enough to make anyone have a mental breakdown. I had friends who cared about me and loved me deeply. I don't know why that wasn't enough. It just wasn't. I felt like no one truly loved me, or ever would. Hell, if my own parents couldn't, then what were my chances with finding a soulmate? Would I just be alone forever and as miserable as I was then? At the time, and in my angsty teen mind, that's exactly what it felt like. Which finally brings us through my background and mindset, leading into the pure, unadulterated hell that was soon to follow. In the midst of my deepest, darkest despair, the brightest idea anyone has ever had on this planet popped into my head. Well, if no one around here will ever love me, then I'll just go online and try to find someone who will. Pure stroke of genius, right? It just made absolute biblical sense to me at the time. I felt like the only gay teen in the whole damn state. Like the only person who really understood me was me, and only ever would be me. That in order to find someone to love me, I had to search far and wide beyond the borders of this mountainous forest I had resided in my entire life. Proud of myself for having such an ingenious idea, I immediately hopped on my MySpace. It was Facebook for us old folk. For all you people saying, "What the fuck is MySpace?" Anyways, I spent the next hour making it look as badass looking as I thought I could. You could customize just about everything on your profile. So of course, mine had to accurately reflect all of my emo feelings and the darkness in my soul. Word to the wise, and something I wished I realized back then. If you're trying to attract the darker things in society, you're probably gonna get back exactly what you're sending out. I know I sure as hell did. It all started out innocent enough. I clicked on one of my gay acquaintances' profile, and for some reason, this guy on his top 8 just flew right out at me. His name was Jacob. He was gorgeous, dressed in all black, and that was pretty much all I needed to know at the time. I saw that he was from Maryland, several hours away from me, but far enough to possibly not be like everyone else around here. Far enough to hopefully have exactly the kind of mentality that I was looking for in another human being. So I sent him a message. Something lame to the effect of, "Hi, what's up? I saw you on my friend's top 8 and thought you were cute, so I figured I would say hello." I wasn't expecting a response. None whatsoever. He was so gorgeous and seemed way too cool for me. So why in God's name would he message a guy like me back? And then it happened. Within a minute of sending him the message, I got one back. And it was from him. I'm not gonna lie, I exploded in joy on the inside, something that I hadn't felt in years and years. It was just something like, "Hey, you're cute too. How are you?" But it was enough to send me over the moon. I felt alive again. But what I really felt was hope again. We talked for the rest of the day and night. We talked about each other, how much life sucked, and how bad we wanted away from our hometown and our lives. You know, the usual for teenage gay boys living in repression. I fell for him hard. Too hard. I mean, hook, line, and sinker hard. We chatted for a week before he had asked me out. I had no problem with dating online. Hell, that was the whole point of me doing this in the first place. So I eagerly said yes. We had only been dating for a week after that or so when he introduced me to the rest of his friends. I met his ex-boyfriend Zachary, and their best friend Josie, who I quickly became best friends with, along with about 10 other girls and guys. Josie was a cool chick, and she had known these guys for years. Who better to give me all the dirt on them? During the course of the next month, Josie and I became the closest friends out of everyone he introduced me to, in what turned out to be a gang. They were mostly just a group of suburban white kids who called themselves the Elites, and just drank and smoked a lot of weed. I had heard some crazy stories here and there about them beating people up, and some of them taking the gang thing way too seriously, but I didn't really think much about it. Josie and I had been talking on the phone every single day, and really made a genuine connection with each other. She had my sense of bizarre humor, was extremely intelligent, and still liked to have a crazy good time on top of it all. During this period, Jacob and I were doing great, but there was one little problem. I had started to fall in love with his ex, Zachary, the more that I talked to him. Jacob could be intense at times, violent when he was angry, from what I had heard, but on the other hand, Zachary was his complete opposite. He was too kind for his own good, an extremely caring guy, and he wrote the most beautiful piano music I had ever heard. Being a musician myself, French horn for 10 years, I was immediately endeared to this guy. The more and more time I spent online talking to Zachary, the less and less time I felt like I was talking to Jacob. Eventually, Jacob kinda figured out what was going on, and to my shock, he let me know that he was cool with it, and wished us the best. That's how after about 2 months with Jacob, I started dating his ex, Zachary. This would be the guy I would date for the next 2 years, and with whom the worst times of my life would be spent. Josie was clearly thrilled for me. We still talked every day online and on the phone. Sometimes I talked to Zachary on the phone, but more often than not, we just kept our communication to AOL Instant Messenger. When we started dating was when everything started to collapse. Jacob, who has initially said he was okay with everything, ended up exploding. He completely tore me a new one online, and then proceeded to go and kidnap my current boyfriend. Josie called me up, freaking me the hell out, saying he'd taken Zachary and no one knew where they were. This clearly sent me reeling from shock. I guess all the rumors I had heard about Jacob were true. And now, because of my actions, the guy I'm in love with is in danger. I quickly contacted some of the older guys in the gang and let them know what was going on. Their response was basically, "Aw, shit, not again." Which caught me off guard. "Again? You mean this happens frequently?" I talked to Chaz, the leader of the gang, while he sent some guys out to deal with Jacob and retrieve my boyfriend. He basically told me in a nutshell that Jacob has been and always will be obsessed with Zachary, that when he gets wasted on whatever, he goes cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, and sets out some wild mission to kidnap and apparently violate my new boyfriend. I couldn't believe it. I mean, I was in complete and total shock. But apparently this situation was resolved easily, and he handed over my man without too much incident. He also received a healthy ass beating to remind Jacob that it's not nice to go around kidnapping people just because you can. This was the first, and certainly not the last, incident I can remember where a pattern I'm all too familiar with now would develop over the next several years. Jacob would get drunk and jealous, he would do something completely insane to me or my boyfriend, and then after all the freaking out and worrying was over with, he would come crying back to me begging mine and Zachary's forgiveness. This became a weekly routine, and it began to wear me out mentally very quickly. Flash forward around a year after I had sent the very first message to Jacob. I was still with Zachary, still best friends with Josie, who I had even been up to Maryland and met in person at this point, unfortunately to miss my boyfriend who was out of town visiting family. And I was still dealing with Jacob's crabtastic insane plots to ruin my relationship and give me a stroke before the age of 20. None of this craziness set off any red flags in my head. Not one. As a matter of fact, nothing period during that entire year gave me second thoughts about anything going on really. That day to day, the sky is falling lifestyle had become the norm for me and I was used to it. Several of my friends, however, had their doubts, though they were polite enough to keep them to themselves for the time being. This was when the first true danger that threatened me and my family ever arose. It led to a night I will never forget as long as I live. Cut to me as a 17-year-old who in the span of 1 year had accomplished everything he set out to do. I had the perfect boyfriend, I had an awesome new best friend in Josie, and I had joined a group of my own in my hometown. My parents were gonna throw me away just because of who I loved. Well, then I was gonna throw away every single religious thing I had ever been taught, and go to the dark side. I became a Luciferian, otherwise known as a Satanist, and boy oh boy did I think I was a badass now. I had received a call one night around 12 a.m. from Josie, who was almost by herself. Very out of character for her. I mean, hell, Zachary had been kidnapped for over 40 times in the past year, and she had hardly ever batted an eye. But this was different. She explained to me that Jacob had really outdone himself and had lost his mind this time. He had hired a guy from the elites named Sean to come down to my house and kill me plus my mother, father, and younger sister. My sister is about 7.5 years younger than me, and from the day she was born, I have always been fiercely protective over her. She was and still is my beautiful baby sister, and truly one of the only one in my household that I loved at the time. When I heard that my ex had taken it so far as to hire a hitman to come after my family, I flew into what we around here call a mountain rage. It didn't matter to me if someone simply came after me, but to target my precious sister who had nothing to do with any of this was the boiling point for me. And even though I despise my parents at the time, I'm still a Southerner, and when you mess with a Southerner's family, then all the crap you're fighting about goes right out the window. Complete and total defend the homestead mode had kicked in. I asked Josie when he left Maryland. She told me she found out that he started driving towards my house maybe an hour ago, and as soon as she found out, she called me immediately. Okay, so that meant I had at the most 6 hours to prepare, and at the least, possibly 4 if he got a good head start. She also informed me that Sean was a former army guy, but got kicked out for failing several psych tests and being a complete sociopath in general. I'm not a big guy, and at the time I weighed even less than I do now. I was about 5'7" and maybe weighed around 130 pounds soaking wet. But my first thought didn't require brute strength to beat back this attacker. I called up my coven leader, Brandon, who lived not even 10 minutes away from me, and explained the situation. I told him I needed to borrow his favorite toy, and I promised to bring it back in good condition with as little blood on it as possible. He agreed. About 30 minutes later, I was back home in my room, cleaning and loading an extremely nice over and under pump action shotgun. Like I said, no brute force required. I called Josie back up and got the details on what exactly he and his car looked like. Then around 4 a.m. I told her I would call her back, and crept out into my front yard. Now for people who had never been to my house, they always got to where to park at wrong. They always ended up in the front of my house, down a hill instead of in the driveway on the side. This little detail was stuck in my head, and probably saved my life. In the very front of my yard, there was a huge oak tree that was big enough for my skinny girl jean wearing emo ass to hide perfectly behind. All I had to do was wait and hope he did exactly what I thought he would. I got so lucky. He parked exactly on the opposite side of the big tree that I was hiding behind. I heard a car door open and someone step outside of the vehicle, shortly followed by the unmistakable cocking of a 9mm handgun. While that sound may have struck fear in the hearts of others, it absolutely enraged me to my core. So I replied in kind with a sound of my own. As I stepped around the side of the tree, he was directly in front of his car, gunned down by his side. In one motion, I simultaneously pumped a shell into the chamber of my shotgun and raised it directly level with his head about 10 feet away from me. This caught him off guard and completely by surprise. I didn't hesitate. I simply told him the God's honest truth. I said, "Buddy, you've got one of two options right now. Either you get back in your car, turn around and drive straight back to Maryland without stopping, or you can so much as flinch in my general direction, and I will splatter your brains all across this great state. You have 5 seconds to decide. What's it gonna be?" I kid you not, the most sickly smile spread across this psycho's face, and for a moment, I thought we were about to reenact the movie Tombstone. Fortunately, he had much more of a sense of self-preservation than I thought someone who would just drive 8 hours to kill a family he never met would have. All he did was give a little chuckle and said, "You're a cool dude. See ya around." He then walked backwards very slowly, my gun following him the entire way, got back into his car and just drove off. Right then and there, I made up my mind. I had to tackle the beast head on. I was raised that if you have a problem, be a damn man and take care of it yourself. I had to go to my enemy Jacob's home turf and bring this war to his doorstep just like he brought it to mine. It was time to go to Maryland. After all the drama of being nearly murdered by a nut job, I'd really had enough of Jacob's bullshit at this point. I got online and cussed him out until a fly wouldn't land on him, making a point to let him know that his little plan backfired. He wasn't dealing with some poor little boy that couldn't fend for himself, and each and every crazy situation that evolved had made me stronger as a person, if not a little bit more mentally disturbed every time. I told him he was going to regret the day he ever crossed me and my boyfriend. Instead of apologizing like usual, his true colors finally came out. He laughed at me. He freaking laughed at me. He told me I was cute when I was angry, and that what a damn shame it was that I didn't have a bullet hole in my head. He wished that I was dead and he never spoke to me in the first place because he was still in love with his ex, my current boyfriend of the year, Zachary. He informed me that the war was just beginning, and that he would do everything in his power to win Zachary back, like he was some kind of adorable trophy you won for baking the best pie at the county fair. I was incensed, completely livid and brimming to the edge with fury. I told him to watch his back, because I'm coming for him. I called Josie and told her everything that happened and asked if I could come stay with her for a week. She excitedly agreed. Zachary was asleep for this whole ordeal, and blissfully unaware that anything had happened. When he found out the next day, I think he was even more angry than I was. Fortunately for us, the gang's leader Chaz liked Zachary a whole hell of a lot more than he did Jacob. So we hatched a plan with him. The idea was for them to kidnap Jacob like he had Zachary so many times before. They would be accomplishing this task while I was on my way up to Maryland, and when I got there he would be mine to do with as I pleased. You can imagine on the 8-hour drive up there all the hideous and heinously brutal ideas that were going through my mind. I was going to inflict maximum amounts of pain on the guy that had caused so much in my own life, and I would relish in every second of it. Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, my dreams of reviving the Spanish Inquisition on my exes had never came to fruition. When I arrived in Maryland, Josie came skipping out to greet me, happy as a lark like always to see me. She had some good and bad news. I always ask for the bad news first, and the bad news was that Jacob had gotten tipped off by Kenny. God, I freaking loathe that guy. Always meddling where he didn't belong. And told him that everyone was coming for him. He made a hasty retreat, and had intended to kidnap Zachary and take him on the run too. But that was the good news. Before he could get to him, Zachary had hopped on a bus and headed to New York to stay with his mom while things cooled off. As sad as I was that once again I had missed seeing him for the first time, I was just relieved that he was out of harm's way. Safe and sound. Again, no alarm bells going off for that second time that I had made the trip up there Zachary was not around. Josie called him on her cell, and he apparently picked up his mom's, because he had never had his own cell, and we got to enjoy one of the rare times we actually spoke on the phone. All was well. Now for a week of fun and plotting on what we were gonna do to Jacob the next time he reared his ugly head. Later on that week, Josie wanted to drive down to an old colonel part of Maryland, and go ghost hunting on these abandoned railroad tracks. However uneventful that may have been, we did end up inviting Sean to go with us. Turns out Psycho Dude actually felt bad. Well, almost. He blankly told me that if I didn't have the balls to stand up to him, he would have killed me and my whole family for just $500. Instead of killing him on the spot, which every fiber in my being was telling me to do, I decided to play nice and get him on my side. That way, if Jacob ever tried that crap again, he would definitely tell him no because I'm the cool dude. Sometimes you catch more flies with honey. Anyways, the rest of the week was normal and a damn good time. Josie and I said our goodbyes and we parted ways, wishing each other a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. The next couple of weeks was semi-normal. No word from Jacob at all. Not even a peep. What a gift, I thought. I'll take it. Year 2 of my relationship began quite happily, believe it or not. Even my birthday month of January was an unusually good one. Then came the next couple of months. 2 months which quite vividly live within me to this day. They also define my life for the next several years. This is when the sky stopped falling, and my world completely crumbled from beneath me into utter devastation. At the beginning of February, Josie had a sudden and urgent impulse to get away from her parents. Now I could completely understand that, so I happily agreed to let her come stay down south with me. I borrowed my best friend's car and drove a 15 to 16 some odd hour round trip all the way down to Maryland and back. My parents were less than thrilled, and they told me she couldn't live in the house with us. So I said fine, and I shelled out my own money to a local La Quinta inn where she and I lived for almost 2 weeks before my parents caved and let us back in the house. Now I forgot to mention something extremely important earlier about my boyfriend Zachary. He was very sick, I mean terminally ill, but we thought it wouldn't be like that for years. I was told he had cystic fibrosis and that he needed a double lung transplant in order to live much longer. He was hospitalized in the beginning of February, and rushed up the transplant list because his condition was so grave. I can't even begin to tell you how after the year we'd been through together how badly I wanted to be by his side. Unfortunately, he was at a hospital in part of the country that specializes in treating CF, and was way too far for me to travel. Josie kept me in pretty good spirits about the whole thing. She had a lot of experience with CF since her sister had also died from it several years earlier. She reassured me that since he was so young, and tried to take good care of himself, that he would probably receive donor lungs very soon and be just fine. I tried not to worry too much, but in reality, I worried my ass off. Losing him after getting him out of harm's way so many times before was not an option in my mind. How could we have overcome so much for him to only succumb to this disease? Zachary and I talked constantly when he felt like it, and even though he was scared and alone, he said he felt like $1 million knowing I was supporting him with my love no matter where I was. That made me feel wonderful being able to comfort him from so far away. And for a couple of weeks, my comfort seemed to be doing the trick. Until one day. My boyfriend died suddenly on February 14th, 2008. His lungs filled with fluid, and he suffocated and died. There was nothing anyone could do. I was completely and totally lost. Josie broke the news and I collapsed into the biggest mess you'd ever seen in your life. She was still living with me at the time, so she tried to console me as best as she could, while she was shedding her own tears at the loss of her best friend. That forever ruined my Valentine's Day for me. To this day, it only reminds me of loss and death. You don't realize how fragile your heart truly is until you've experienced a loss like that. Little did I know that even worse moments in my life were about to occur a month later. I was headed on a course for total destruction, and still blissfully unaware of the person who had been driving this crazy train from day one. Skip forward to March, St. Patrick's Day to be exact. A little over a month since Zachary had passed away, Josie had forcefully been returned to Maryland by her parents, seeing as how she had practically ran away. I was off in La La Land in booze, drugs, and more pain than either of those could cover up. I was chilling with my Satanist posse, doing what all American teenagers do on St. Patty's Day, pretending like we're Irish and testing the limits of alcohol poisoning. My alcohol tolerance back then was ridiculously high, so I had already drank an inordinate amount when my phone rang. It was Josie. I slurred my words to something of the effect of, "Hey girl, what you doing?" I announced to the room it was Josie, to which everyone replied, "Hey." She had lived with us for several months, and lover or hater, she'd become an honorary Southerner. The next words out of her mouth, once again, sent my head spinning off into space and my world into complete chaos. "Zachary's not dead." I stopped breathing for a moment, and when I caught my breath, I asked her to repeat that again. She did. Except this time she had added the fact that his life had been in danger, so she had to hide him from me. Jacob just had to think he was dead. I could literally feel my brain dripping out from my ears as my mind turned into mush with every word out of her mouth. Then, for the real kicker to my drunken mental meltdown, Zachary got on the phone. Sure enough, it was his voice. He apologized for what he had to do. I apologized for what I was about to do, which was scream and yell my lungs out, throw my phone into a wall, smashing it into 1,000,000 pieces. And then go from super hammered drunk to completely shit-faced wasted. I drank everything that wasn't nailed down. Who knows what other drugs I did on top of that, because I sure don't remember. I was literally having a complete and total mental breakdown. The last strand of sanity in my brain just snapped. I did this for a couple more hours until I somehow drove back home, put on my work clothes, and tore out of the parking lot to go to my job in the city, half an hour down the interstate with people chasing me trying to stop me. I don't recall any of what happened next, but apparently this is what I did. I showed up to work completely wasted and got fired from a damn good job. I called my father, freaking out in the parking lot of said job. He realized I was drunk and told me to stay there and he would come get me. Oh, how I wish crazy drunk me would have listened. Instead of doing that, I started driving on the interstate again, not caring if I lived or died. And obviously not caring about anyone else. According to the police report, I was tearing down the interstate at 130 miles per hour. I apparently hit 2 mile markers on the side of the road and blew both of my right-hand tires, but continued on driving with sparks shooting 50 feet out of the back of my car. I took the exit to the hospital going that fast and spun out, completely totaled what was left of my car. According to bystanders, I then proceeded to exit my vehicle and run across the damn interstate towards the hospital with people chasing after me. Once I got to the ER doors, I heard the now familiar whoop whoop of a police cruiser. I was arrested for driving under the influence. I blew a .20 about 12 hours after I had my last drink. If I had blown a .21, I would have gotten a felony charge. That led to a year of failed drug tests, violated probations, and ultimately a year in jail down the line. After that, I decided enough was enough. These crazy people from Maryland and their insane concept of living could all go to hell as far as I was concerned. It had been nearly 2 years of torment, fear, and unimaginable pain. The worst of it all was starting to cost me my mind and my freedom. I was done listening to Josie, and ready to start listening to my actual friends in town, who had been begging me to stay away from those people for a long time now. some good friends sat me down and started to tell me the inconsistencies in all their stories over the last few years. At first I didn't want to listen, but then eventually there was too much evidence not to listen. Finally, I opened my ears and my mind to what was really going on. I decided to figure this out once and for all. I got on MySpace, Facebook, and every social media I could think of. I typed in Josie's full name into the search bar of every single one. What I found out to this day still makes me want to turn my stomach contents inside out. There on every social media possible, by using her name and the few email addresses I knew she had, I found dozens and dozens of accounts linked to her emails. Duplicate after duplicate of Zachary's full name on accounts with pictures of her, and the same thing with Jacob and every single solitary other person in the supposed elites. That's when it finally, after years of denial and torment, it finally freaking hit me like a railroad car full of bricks. Holy shit! She's every single one of these people. She absolutely and unequivocally made up every single solitary one of these people, and has been pretending to be a dozen or more people for over 2 years. As you can imagine, my jaw hit the damn floor. Thank God I had some close friends there who kept me from falling apart and helped me find every single fake profile she had ever created. I was dumbfounded. Profile after profile after profile that had her pictures but the names of people I thought were very real. Prototype accounts before she ended up making the actual fake accounts. Gag or jokes to her, really. In fact, all of this had to be one big insane psychotic joke. I was too shocked to be enraged yet, but don't worry, that's coming. I diligently copied every link to every single one of her profiles into my AOL Instant Messenger. And then I called her. Hey, how are ya? I'm alright, I guess, just bored, you? Nope. Definitely not bored over here. Get on AIM chat and I'll show you something really interesting. I was nearly hysterical at that point, and I could tell she knew something was up. Once she was online, I simply asked her, hey Josie, what are these? Then sent her the link to every single fake profile she had ever created in her miserable life, and a few from email accounts that I didn't even know belonged to her. The silence on the other end of the line was deafening, as I heard her clicking through link after link. Her 2-year-long mental game was over, and she finally realized it. Her words? Well, fuck, man. Guess you got me. She then started to laugh, genuinely laugh as though something remotely funny had just occurred. I don't recall what I said, but apparently it was bad enough for my friends to take away the phone and have to hold me down. Catfish the show or movie wasn't around way back then, so I had to unwittingly become one of the first hardcore victims of a stalker in the internet age. Worse than that, I had talked to, lived with, and even befriended the girl who had been stalking and trying to ruin my life for over 2 years. It was literally, and still is, the single biggest mindfuck I have ever had in my entire life. Thousands upon thousands of messenger conversations, hundreds and thousands of hours of phone conversation, countless amounts of cash being spent to drive several states away just to stay with my psycho stalker every single time. Even bringing her down to live with me for months, having $5,000 mysteriously vanished out of my bank account. Everything was starting to make sense. There was no Jacob, there was no Zachary, there was no gang. What there actually was one completely batshit insane girl with more mental problems than one could fit into an encyclopedia. She was the only person I ever talked to. She was the only person I ever saw. And even she was the one that paid Sean to come down to my house with a gun and try to kill my entire family. Josie was the only person in these last 2 years that had orchestrated any of this. From all the fake kidnappings and boyfriend drama, to faking the death of someone who I had fallen in love with and bringing him back to just screw with my head. Who the hell does that? All the events of the last 2 years came flooding into my mind, as I realized in each and every one, it was solely her and no one else but her. So many questions raced through my head, the least of all being why me. I deleted my MySpace and made my Facebook private. I only accept friends that I knew are real. I fell completely off the wagon and out of my head. Drugs, alcohol, and more drugs. That's all I could do to cope. Here I was, a gay man that unknowingly fallen in love with a straight woman, and regardless of whether or not I thought it was a gay man, which I wholeheartedly did, that shit still fucks with you in the head pretty bad. I didn't think I could ever be close to someone again. My world had been rocked and ruined. To this day, all those years later, I still do not trust people. I don't think I'll ever be able to trust someone ever again. Can you blame me? She came down here. Yup, you heard me right. That bitch moved into my sister town not even half an hour away from me. I bumped into her by accident and we started talking. Again, as much as I wanted to stomp her in a bloody pulp on the ground, you can catch more flies with honey. I wanted answers. Hell, I deserved them. I told her I was just trying to forgive her and needed answers to my questions in order to do so. I asked her if she would sit down with me and tell me everything, and she reluctantly agreed. I politely informed her that this forgiveness was not for her, but it was for me so I could stop holding on to and living in the past. I explained she nearly killed me and ruined my life, and what she did was the most personal and horrific thing one human being can do to another. Especially after I was so damn good to her. She was polite, and she let me get everything off of my chest. I tried to be calm and not rude so she wouldn't run away. I did get closure somewhat and answers to everything. Here's her explanation. Take it with a grain of salt. It started out as a joke when she was in high school. There was a girl who was being mean to her and bullying her, so she thought she'd get back to her by getting her to like a guy online and reveal the awful truth later. Haha. She made a bunch of prototype profiles and eventually almost 20 profiles in total, so it looked like this group of people had the same friends and they were real. She just pulled pictures off of freaking Google. She knew none of these people in real life. She was having a good old time tricking this girl, when along comes a spider to mess up her web. Me. She said she thought she would just mess with me a bit and let me know she was actually a girl, but after talking to me, she unintentionally fell in love with me. Whether that's true or not, I don't know what to believe. If she really did love me, then why put me through pure freaking hell for 2 years? She said she wanted to tell me a million times, but just got out of control. And before she knew it, she was really getting into being these people and somewhat believed she was them and they were real. Again, this chick is the world's best bullshitter I've ever met, so who knows what the truth really is. All I wanted to know was how did she get the music and how did she sound like a guy on the phone? The music, as she shockingly demonstrated to me, was actually hers. She's an amazing pianist and guitar player. I saw this with my own eyes and heard it with my own ears. Zachary's voice on the phone wasn't very complicated. She paid a guy friend a few bucks to be in on it, which this jerk-off eagerly agreed to. Ruining someone's life for a few bucks. How sweet. Sean was also all her. She paid him 500 bucks to do that and she had zero explanation as to why. She knew he would do it. He's just as much a psycho as she is. The rest of it was pure fantasy and imagination. All dolled up to be extra crazy so I would care more about Zachary and give her more attention. As lie after lie was finally revealed and the truth brought to life, I had heard enough after 8 hours of this. I'd heard everything I ever really needed to hear and wanted to. My life was nearly destroyed, my family nearly killed, my mental and emotional health left scarred forever, and ever simply because she wasn't getting enough attention in her life. Neither was I when all that started, but I didn't go about like a human wrecking ball trying to make myself feel better. I'll never be able to comprehend or understand the mind of someone like that. People who derive pleasure from other people's pain and misery. I'll never be able to fully trust, not in the way that's required of a true partner and companion. I just can't do that again. If I'm mortally betrayed again, I know the next time will kill me. So as I write this in my apartment a little over a decade after it all happened, I'm alone. One good thing did come from this. It sure as hell made me the person I am today, and it strengthened and toughened my resolve into tempered steel. I learned to be okay with myself, and to finally love myself after so many years of self-loathing. I'm a pretty amazing person. I don't need a man to define my life, and who I am in any shape, form, or fashion. Obviously, I'm worth something. Otherwise, this psycho chick wouldn't have latched onto me for years. And ending up moving 8 hours away from her home to be 30 minutes away from me all this damn time. What she stole from me, I will never get back. But what I gained, she can never take away from me again.